pastor of First Baptist Church of Instrument, I have been asked to serve as the officiant for these homegoing services of Sister Lucy K. Peterson on this morning. The order of service has been already established by the family, and we shall follow it as printed. I would ask that Minister Altrice Jones and Minister Aubrey McDonald would, when their time comes, please come to this area in order to fulfill your assignment for your family. And so we will now proceed as printed. God bless you.
It belongs to someone.
Thank you.
shall we pray. Eternal and all-wise God, who is the God of all comfort, in the midst of pain, in the midst of loss, in the midst of, Lord, pain, suffering, confusion, agony. Dear God, in the midst of what this day could represent, dear God, we thank you that there's not a sorrow on this earth that you created that you cannot heal. That God, you are still the one that sits high and don't just look low, you get low with us. This is what we are going through, and at this hour in which we are assembled, dear God, we are coming asking that you would hear our prayers. God, asking that you would forgive us of the sin that we have committed against you. That God, before we can ask for anything, we ask that you would forgive us. God, forgive us because we don't know when our name would be called. God, we want to stand before your throne without blemish, without wrinkle, without stain or spot, covered by the blood of Jesus. So Lord, now we ask for forgiveness. We ask, dear God, that you would intercede and even at points intervene. There's hour in which this family has assembled at First Baptist. Lord, not to say farewell, but to say see you later. Because God, we know from our faith and from what we have been taught that we don't grieve like the world, who grieves as they have no hope, but our hope. Instilled by those who have gone on before us, remind us that our hope is still in the resurrected Jesus. And the same way that he got up, there's a promise that we will as well. So God, we come to celebrate the life of Sister Peterson. God, thanking you for her life and the impact that she had, not only at First Baptist, but in the lives of those that God that knew her, from her family to her friends and to those familiar acquaintances. We thank you right now for a life well lived. That God, she went from labor to reward. That God, she now has a new body. She now no longer has to be in pain. No longer taking medicine. No longer letting folk look after her. Now, God, she sits in the rafters of heaven with the great cloud of witnesses watching over everybody else. We pray right now, God, that you will comfort these children, these grandchildren, these great-grands, these nieces, these nephews, God, that you will look after those that God that's going to miss her more than us. We ask right now, God, that your peace, which surpasses all understanding, will rest upon you. The God in hours in which they remember laughs and conversations and situations, God, even down to the punishments they will receive, that God, they will remember it with joy, because it would not be where they are if it had not been for mom. So Lord, we are asking, sir, please hear our prayer. Don't abandon this family when all the calls have stopped coming in. That God, when people stop asking, how are you doing? Lord, we need you to be there for you. We need you, dear God, because you can be there in the
rise of the morning. When did God tears will fall, minds will race. But God, you are able to keep them in perfect peace because their minds will remain on you. We thank you. Pray right now for Pastor Peterson, specifically as he stands at this sacred desk. Did God to do something in a child but not have the courage to do it? That is to say something about calling God. Be with him at this very hour. God, let his words come from you. Let it be sweet to our ears to encourage us to trust you just as his mother trusted you. We ask right now that you would give him power in order that your will might be done. Keep this family in your care. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. Amen. it shall strengthen thy heart. Again, wait, I say, on the Lord. May God bless each of you in the hearing of his word, which is true and power. God bless you. God loves you. God keep you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, right now. We thank God for the gift of Sister Lucy Peterson. We can't be selfish. She was not only our gift as children and siblings, but she has been a gift to so many. But I just want to share a few of her lines of legacy in our lives. She brought us up in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. She reinforced the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. But the fear of mother, the beginning of wisdom was just a continuation of wisdom. She believed in the scriptures. If you spoil the child, if you spare the rod. And she knew how to use the rod. She didn't believe in time out. She believed in going to the belt or to the tree to get the switch.
Amen.
She believed if you spare the rod, you'll spoil the child. She believed in training. Training up a child in the way that he should go. She believed in training you how to clean.
All right.
I wash windows in and out. I swept a porch in the wintertime. I took out trash. I was getting like the garbage man. Rain, sleep, or snow, I had to take the trash out. I learned how to do household chores.
All right.
I thought she had no respect of persons. And I mentioned that to her one day, and I said, "Now, you have me washing dishes, washing clothes, babysitting, cleaning up the house, cooking, mending socks, I'm cutting grass, running errands. But you don't have my sister." Congrats. She said, "I'm training you in the way you should be." But then she had an unclean streak that she shared. And that was her faith in God. All of my siblings benefited from that faith. She wasn't alone. My father also had the same faith.
Amen.
And they united with that faith and was examples of that faith in God that aided us in maturing and having faith in God. And for that, I'm truly thankful.
Amen.
If you read the obituary, you will see many other things that she has done. We thank God for the contribution she's made. She loved people.
Amen.
She was a great counselor to others. bringing courage to others, a great supporter of others. I never will forget. Mother had a calm spirit sometime. I think she thought I was my bigot. You know how y'all women get things from your husband by happening. Amen. So we went to visit her in the nursing home. And we got there, she was a little scared for what reason, I don't know. So we sit there about an hour. She didn't say a word. So when we got ready to leave, I said, love you, Mom. See you later. Don't leave. I said, Mom, Jesus said he would never leave. Not forsake you, but I'm going to leave you, but I'm not going to forsake you. She didn't do that no more. I love my mother. She was a great inspiration. She taught us many things as a family. She taught us, number one, to respect others. She taught us to love one another. She taught us humility. Not to think ourselves higher than we are. Now other people thought that about us. Amen. But we didn't think that about ourselves. It's just the way that she taught us to carry ourselves. And if you notice one thing, my whole family has the same gratitude. She always said, thank you. And if you notice my family, we always say, thank you. Whatever you do, we're going to say, thank you. A legacy to live on. But let me share a word of encouragement today as we continue this journey, as God has allowed her to finish hers on this earth. Philippians chapter 3 and verses 13 and 14, you'll find these words that were written by Paul. Paul says in the 13th verse, brother, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are before. I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. I'm talking about a servant. Striving for the living Christ.
Amen.
A servant striving for the living Christ. A servant striving for the living Christ. Paul said in this text, addressed him having some spiritual goals. I truly believe that every believer ought to have some spiritual goals. If you don't have any, I suggest that you set some now. You need some spiritual goals. You ought to have a sanctified ambition in being a Christian and living the Christian life. It's not enough just to say, I joined the church. I've been baptized.
All right.
My name is on the church roll. I sing in the choir. I work on the worship board. But you ought to have some spiritual ambitions about your Christian life. You need to realize that you are running a race. This is a spiritual race. This life that you have accepted as Jesus Christ has saved you is a life that you begin to live daily. Not occasionally, but daily. It is your life. When you wake up, it's your life. When you go to work, it's your life. When you go shopping, it's your life. When you go downtown to other activities, it's your life. When you go where you don't need to go, it's your life. It's a Christian life. It's every time, all time, everywhere life. Amen?
Amen.
So you need to have some spiritual ambitions, sanctified ambitions. And I believe my mother had some sanctified ambitions as I look at this text. First of all, Paul talks about he didn't want anybody to suppose, and he didn't believe that he had already arrived. Amen? I don't care how long you've been in the faith. She lived 100 years, but she didn't arrive, didn't attain all in that 100 years. Amen? It's not going to matter how long it is, but you're still from the day you receive to the day you die. You're striving, moving forward, upward, to be that Christ. Some of us get content because we learn how to pray. Or we can say a prayer. Well, we can quote some scriptures. When we can have some experiences in faith and miracle working in our lives. But you haven't arrived yet. There are some things you still need to grow in. Growing in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The race that God has set before us is a Christian race. So Paul say he's going to deal with it in three perspectives in this text. He learned how to press ahead in three ways. First, we see that he says, forget those things which are behind. You need a sanctified forgetfulness. Amen? Forgetting those things that are behind you. Then he says, look forward to the things that are before you. You need a sanctified remembrance. Thirdly, he says, press on towards the mark of the prize of God calling. You need a sanctified striving for that which God has called you. Forget the past. Some of us like to lean on the past, not what we used to be. Amen. You can't live on what you used to do. I was talking to someone the other day, and they was telling me, they used an example of driving a car. You have your rear view mirror. And you can't go forward by continually looking in the rear view mirror and trying to hold focus on those things in the rear view mirror. Because if you focus on the rear view mirror, you're going to have a wreck. There are some things that we need to let go. The good, the bad. You have to sometimes let go. Amen.
Amen.
Your imperfections, your mistakes. You have to let go. Ask God forgiveness, repent of it. Now nobody might not forget, but that won't let you hold you back. Amen. We have to make progress. We have to mature. And we need to stop trying to be what we are. Paul said that I've been young. I've been young. But now I am old. And I never seen the righteous person. I just keep begging. You can't stay young. I don't know, we can do all kind of things to make ourselves appear. Days and years and all those other things and make up and make out. But behind all of that, you're still old. And I don't care how you try to strut. It's hard to hit you.
Come on. How long do you?
You're going to miss that strut.
Come on. All right now.
Nah. But we can't allow things to overshadow the present. Amen. We have to look forward to the work that God has at hand for us in the present. Then we need to reach forward. Reach forward. We're not going backwards. We're not staying stalemated. We're not staying where we are. You can't have a contented life as a Christian by what you used to do. Amen.
Amen.
Because you won't be able to do what you used to do. Did you get over it? Amen.
Amen.
I hear so many of us as church. We said we can't come to church. Can't thirst you, we can't stand, can't sing. I admit those things. But there's some other things you can do. You can pray. You can be a prayer warrior. You can be an encourager. You can be a witness for God. I noticed my mother in the facility and her roommate. One day I came in and the roommate said, "You know, your mother helped me to see Christ. She wasn't able to walk, but she was able to witness, to share. Even by her example, she became a living testimony." And we all can do something. As life changes, as these old bodies give down, we still have a striving to do. Because Paul said, "For me to live is Christ." I don't care how long you're living, what condition you are, why you're living, you still, for you to live is Christ. Then he says, pressing towards you. You need some marks. Amen. There is a prize. The prize is already waiting for you. But you got some marks to go by. Amen. You need to have some marks. And the marks, I see mistakes. The first mark is a mark of faith. You need a saving faith first. If you're going to run this journey, Live this Christian life, you need a saving faith person. You need to be saved. I'm not talking about your name on the roll. I'm saying you need to be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. In Him is where you're going to have your salvation and your deliverance, because He's the one who died for you. Believe in Him. The Bible says He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father, but you need a saving. Then you need a living faith. The gesture to live by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. An everyday faith walk.
All right.
An everyday dependence on God.
Yes, sir.
You do know He's sovereign, don't you?
Yes, sir.
You know that He has a powerful word, don't you?
Yes, sir.
You don't know that He has a perfect will, don't you? We have to have a living faith. Day by day, we have to live it. So many of us have a talking faith, but you need a living faith. Talk about how much we believe and trust in God. But when you have the experience, the circumstance, the trial, then you got to live faith. Can I trust God with all thine heart and lean not to thine own understanding? When it don't look right. But we need to be like your golden state. Yet, will I trust? You need the mark of hope. A hope, the confidence in God and what He has promised. Are you leaning on His word today? That's where my hope is based on. His promise. His word. Not yours. Amen. Ours will fail. But God will sustain. His word is true. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and righteousness. Then you need to pass the mark of love. You don't need to speak in tongues a whole lot. Because you need to make church. And I don't know about you, but I would prefer me knowing what I'm talking to. You need to look up with all your heart, soul, mind, and spirit. And then you need to love your neighbor. As you said, you need to love your family, your spouses. Amen. You need to love your Christian brother. I didn't say like. I said look. We talking about the marks that you running the race at. Then you need to learn how to love your Then you got to have the final mark. The final mark is meeting death.
Yeah.
If you live in this world, there's a great possibility that you're going to meet death. It's on the Christian road, the Christian race. Do I have a witness? Sometimes we look at death as an enemy. But I want you to see death not as an enemy, but as a friend to a believer.
Amen.
Paul said, when this book shall have put on incorruption, and this water shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who's given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. It's the last one. And then the last one, as you finish this warfare, because the Christian journey is a spiritual warfare, as you complete your march, you set your goals, you can say, like Paul, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith. There is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, not for me only, but those who wait for me. Amen.
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 Amen. Beams of heaven.
Oh, I got one.
In heaven.
Come on.
I go. Down here, below Lord, in
Outside portion of our church.